This morning. Give a praise, give a glory. for the great things you will do. We extol your majesty. We worship you for who you are. We worship you for what you are. We join the angels to give glory to your name this morning. Because you alone deserves it. No man can take your place. No man can share your glory. Yes, we worship you. Make a joyful noise.
Thank you. to your ears this morning. Lord, plant our feet on higher ground, O Lord. Find us faithful, Lord, that by faith we may remain on heaven's table land. In the mighty name of Jesus. We give you praise, O Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus. All right, it's time for our congregational prayer, and I want us to begin to thank God. I want you to begin to thank God. Why are you thanking God? In fact, today's prayer, we are going to deposit prayer. We are going to deposit Thanksgiving this morning. We are going to deposit Thanksgiving. This is the first day in a new month. This is the second month in the second half of this year, and God has kept us. God has been faithful to us. I want us to give God advanced Thanksgiving this month because we are expectant. Because we are expectant, remember that the words of our mouth, we are the ones that declare. The Bible says that God spoke the world into existence. So we know that the power of the word, we know that the words that we speak, they are life. They are life. And as our theme, as our Numbers 14:28 says, that as we declare is yes. So we need one to us. I want you to deposit thanksgiving in God, the thanksgiving bag for. Well, I don't know about you, but I believe that God has that bag for every one of us. So for my own bag this morning, I'm going to load all the thanksgiving. I'm going to thank God. Thank God for life. Thank God for life. Thank God that you are here. Some people started this year. They didn't even enter into the second half of this year. It is not them saying. It is what we know. It is what we know. So please thank God for life. There are some things that we should not take for granted. Don't take life for granted. Don't take the fact that you go in, you go out and come in every day for granted. That you came to church this morning, don't take it for granted. Because there's so much going on now. So much insecurity, so much hardship, so much, so many of everything. But God has kept us. God has kept us. God has sustained our life. The giver of life has sustained our life. The devil has not snuffed out our life. We are well, we are healthy, we are healthy. And God, we give you praise that we came here this morning. Even those that have gone to the hospital, they have come back. They are here. Father, we just want to thank you. We do not take your gift for granted. We do not take your grace for granted. That we are alive, we are well, we are fulfilled. Father, we just want to say thank you. Lord, accept our praise. Accept our thanksgiving. Accept our thanksgiving. You are God. Every time we have looked up onto the hills, Lord, you have been our help. You have been our refuge. You have been all that we are. Father, we just want to say thank you. We just want to say thank you. This morning, we want to deposit advanced thanksgiving because this month is our month of new beginnings. Because we know that you are going to do new things for us. We want to begin to thank you for those things that you are going to do. We want to begin to thank you from every day, from the beginning of this month. We want to begin to say thank you, Lord. Why are we thanking? Because we are expectant. We are expectant. We know that you can do much more. We know that you are able to do much more. Father, we give you praise. We give you glory. We thank you, our living God. We thank you, our mighty Father. We thank you, our faithful God. We thank you, our amazing God. We thank you, our awesome Father. We thank you, our merciful God. We thank you, our rock, our fortress. We thank you for the one that we call unto every day. The God that hears. The God that hears. The God that answers. The God that delivers. Father, we just want to say thank you for your mercy. The Bible says you give mercy to whom you have mercy on. You have compassion on whom you have compassion on. Because we are here, we know that we are recipients of your compassion. We are recipients of your mercy. And we just want to say thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, we have given thanks. I want to read Psalm 103 to us from verse 1 to 5. Bless the Lord, Psalm 103, verse 1 to 5. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Who forgiveth all our iniquities, who healeth all our diseases, who redeemeth our life from destruction, who crowneth us with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfied our mouth with good things, so that our youth is renewed like the eagle. Open your mouth and begin to thank God that has done all these things. Who forgives us despite our misbehavings? Who forgives us despite our shortcomings? Who forgives us despite our silliness and our stupidness? God is good to us. God is gracious to us. God who keeps us. God who preserves us. Let me just read verse 8 as well of that psalm. It says that the Lord is merciful and he is gracious. He is slow to anger. He is plenteous in mercy. Father, we thank you for your mercy. We thank you for your mercy. For as the heaven is high above the earth, so great is his mercy towards us that fear him. Father, we thank you. Oh, great is your mercy towards us. Great is the love of Father, bring your mercy towards us. We just want to say thank you. We just want to say thank you. And as far as the east is from the west, you have removed our transgressions from us. You have removed our sins from us. Every time we ask Lord, forgive us, you forgive us. Every time we ask Lord, forgive us, you hear us, and you cleanse us, and you make a way for us. You give us new beginnings. You make a way in the wilderness for us. Even when things are tight, even when it seems as if we are choking, even when it seems as if we are overwhelmed by situation and circumstance around us, but you are there. Our help in ages past. We call upon you and you hear us. Even when we cannot see you answering, when we cannot see what you are doing, we know that you are there. Even when we are weary, we are tired, Lord, you carry us in your arms and you move with us, because we know that we need to keep moving. We need to keep moving. So even when we are down and we are fainting, you just pick us up and you continue to move in this journey of life. Father, we are grateful. We are grateful to be children of the Most High, to be children of this merciful God, to be children of this awesome Father. Thank you, Jesus, for safety, for security, for protection. We go out every day and we come back in. Ah, Lord, you keep us. We have not been kidnapped. We have not been we have not been kidnapped. Nobody has called anybody for our ransom. Father, we just want to say thank you. We just want to say thank you. We have not gone out and stray bullets has met us on the way. It has not been our portion. Father, we want to say thank you. We want to thank you, Lord, that we have not had accident, that our lives have been snuffed out. We just want to say thank you, Lord. We have not gone to the hospital and not come back. Ah, Father, we just want to say thank you. Who are we that you are so mindful of us? Who are we that we are so mindful of us? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your grace, for your mercy. Father, we thank you in the mighty name of Jesus. And I want us to begin to thank God for King's Chamber, Lekki. I want you to begin to thank God for this ministry. Let's do it like this. Let's thank God for our senior pastors. Let's thank God for our father and mother in the Lord. Let's thank God for all our pastors. Let's thank God for all our ministers. Let's thank God for all our HODs and assistants. Let's thank God for all our members. Let's thank God for the Redemption Inheritance Ministry. God called a man and said, go and start this ministry. And this man obeyed. And because of that, we are children. We are here. We are the sheep in this pasture. We just want to say thank you for this ministry. We have not gone down. We have not been snuffed out. We have not thinned out the need to smoke. Lord, you have been good to us. You have been merciful. We thank you for the covenant of life over us. We have not lost anyone. That covenant continues to speak life, life, life. And Lord, we are so grateful, because it's not just for us, for our families, for our loved ones. That covenant of life speaks for us. We want to say thank you. Thank you for life. Thank you for life. Now also begin to thank God for the King's Chamber, Lekki. Thank God for every family represented in this installation. Thank God for keeping us. Thank God for preserving us. We have had so many, those that have been sick and have come out of it. Those that have had to go to the hospital, God has been faithful. Those that have been having troubling headaches, they have not dropped down and died. We have not lost anyone. Despite all the insecurities, despite all the fears and all the unstableness of the country, none of us are missing. Father, we just want to say thank you. We want to give you praise. We want to give you glory, O Lord. We counted every one of our members, our families. Lord, we are complete. No one is missing. We want to say thank you. Despite difficulties, despite situations that have even encompassed us around, you have not allowed it to swallow us. Because we come every morning to hear your word. Every Sunday morning we gather, because we know that your word does us good. Father, we just want to say thank you. Thank you for this installation. We thank you for the citadel of favor. Thank you for your favor upon us. And for everyone that has stepped into this installation, this citadel of favor, we thank you, Lord, for their lives. In the mighty name of Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Now we're going to thank God for Nigeria, because this is our fatherland. This is our motherland. Oh, this is our land. Let's open our mouth and thank God. Despite the situation and circumstance, despite the economy, despite the fact that the dollar is something else now, I don't even know what to say. And you know, every time the dollar goes up like that, people that are selling pepper in the market, the money will go. Those that are selling, what are the things that we can plant? Eggs. Every month, everything just goes up. And you're like, if those are even selling ugu, the money goes up that. We ask that, are you people exchanging dollar? Are you buying it in? Are you importing it? We don't know, but everything just goes up. This is, I don't even know what to use. It's ridiculous. But God is faithful. God is good. And so we are going to thank God that despite these insecurities, people are afraid to go out. People are just, they don't want to go out. It's not because they are afraid. because of so many, and there are so many things we are seeing. For God is good. Ah, let's open our mouth and say, Lord, despite all, we declare that you are good. Despite all, we know, and because we are thanking you, we know that you will do much more for us. Lord, we thank you for peace in this land. We thank you for peace. Remember what we are doing. We are depositing those thanksgivings because we know that God will do us good. My prayer for Nigeria is Psalm 126. That is my prayer for Nigeria every day, Psalm 126. That when the Lord comes, when the Lord will turn captivity of Nigeria around, we will be like a dream. It will be like the dream. Those that have afar of and mocked and laughed and said, ah, what if I in Nigeria? They will be surprised. They will come and they will laugh with us. They will, with their mouth, they will declare that, ah, this is the Lord's will. It can only be done by an awesome God. And they will be rejoiced. They will laugh with us. So open your mouth and say, Lord, I thank you, because there's nothing that God cannot do. There's no situation that God cannot turn around. Even the one that is seemingly impossible, or it cannot be attained. If God can make it possible in a country that they were eating themselves, God turned it around overnight and they had excess, then how much more is Nigeria? There's nothing God cannot do. Please open your mouth and say, Lord, thank you. Thank you for Nigeria. Thank you. Despite what we are hearing, what we are seeing, what is happening, we choose to thank you, because you are a good God. You are a God of peace. We thank you, Lord, because, Lord, you are able to turn our situation around for good. Even though it looks impossible, we thank you, because we know that you are the God of impossibilities, the God that turns impossibilities to possibilities. We know that is the mighty God that we serve. And because we know that you are the only one that can do this, we choose to thank you, because you know that you will do us good, in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, then you, for the sake of, I mean, for the sake of the righteous, we are more than one, we are more than two righteous in this country. That is why we are convinced, we know that you will truly save us. You will truly save us. Father, we want to say thank you. We say thank you. We give you praise. We give you glory. In Jesus' mighty name, we have given thanks. Finally, I want you to thank God for yourself. What God has in store for you this month. This is our month of new beginnings. God, there are some things that God wants to turn around. There are some things that God wants to do. Let me read Isaiah chapter 43 and verse 19 to us. Let me read it to us. There are some things that God wants to do. So we need to begin to deposit that thanksgiving in preparation for what God will do. Isaiah chapter 43 and verse 19. All right. It says, behold, I will do a new thing now. I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall ye not know it? I will even make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. Behold, now, our thing, God's word to us this month, through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, our Father in the Lord, it is a month of new beginning. It's because God wants to do new things. It's because God wants to turn situations around. It's because God is giving us another opportunity to show himself mighty. Please project that our month of new beginning, Revelation chapter 25. I want us to be seeing it as we are praying this prayer. That's that beautiful DP by our media people. You need to be seeing it. Mr. Bayo read that Revelation chapter 21. We are backing it up with Isaiah chapter 43, 19, that God will do a new thing. Will you not know it? You will see it. Why? Because Numbers 23, 19 says that God is not a liar. God is not man that he should lie. When he says it, he will do it. And so I want you to lift up your voice, open your mouth and say, Lord, thank you for this month of new beginnings. Lord, you want to do something new. Lord, I want to thank you because of that, what you want to do this month. You are the one that makes a way in the wilderness. You are the one that makes the desert fill up. You are the one that can do impossible things that man eye has not seen, ear has not heard, has not entered into the heart of man. That is what you can do, and you are set to do that on my behalf. Lord, I just want to thank you. I just want to thank you. I just want to thank you for my family, for my life, for that what you want to do to show yourself mighty in my life. Lord, I just want to thank you. You are a good God. You are a faithful God. Lord, I receive all my thanksgiving. I bring everything this morning. I want to come and enter it into my thanksgiving basket before you this morning, because you deserve it. Because you can do much more. Because you are faithful. Because you are good. Lord, receive my thanks. Receive my thanks. Receive my worship. Receive my all. Receive my all, Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. This is me. This is all me. This is it. Emina Reolua, receive my thanks. Emina Reolua, receive my thanks. Receive my thanks in the mighty name of Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name, we have given thanks.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Finally, let's project our DPC for this morning. And of course, it's Revelation 21 and verse 5. And he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. How many things?
All things.
Who is making new things? Is it you?
Oh,
it's not so. The one that sits upon the throne in heaven. The one that he has not changed his address. Is there any other place that we can find God? The creator of the universe. The king of kings and lord of lords. The one that made us. He's telling us this morning that behold, I make all things new. And so with that, with looking, appreciating the sovereignty of our God, we are going to declare this month, I have newness of life.
I have newness of life.
Newness of ideas.
Newness of ideas.
Newness of opportunities to excel.
Newness of health.
Newness of health.
Newness
of connections.
Newness of
zeal.
Newness of
zest. New song. New. Open your mouth and just declare all the new things that you want God to do for you. This month, I receive a new song. I'm going to be singing a new song this month. I'm going to be singing a new song this month. Because this month of new beginnings, I step into it. I receive newness of everything. Newness of everything. Newness of ideas. Newness of opportunities. Newness of opportunities to excel. New doors are opening unto me. New doors are opening unto me. Newness of connections. Everywhere I need connections. Everywhere I need people to favor and rise up to speak for me. Lord, I receive it in the name of Jesus. Newness of zeal. Newness of zeal. Newness of sex. Newness to be excited in the presence of God. Newness of strength, able to excel in the name of Jesus. I receive it this morning. I receive it this morning. And I run with it to the end of this year in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we give you praise. We give you glory. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you, Lord, for your word. We give you all the praise. We give you all the glory in the mighty name of Jesus. And as we have spoken to your ears, according to Numbers 14:28, so will you do unto us because you have heard us. Because we know that your ears are not closed and you cannot stop that. Your hands are not shut and they are upset. So because we know you have heard us, the God that we call on to and he answers us, has heard us this morning. We expect him this month, this month till the end of this year, of new beginnings, of new things, of new great things. Father, we give you praise, we give you glory. We bless your holy name, O Lord. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Amen. Hallelujah. As we take our seats, let's invite our new choir. Hallelujah. New, refired, and reignited choir to come and bless us with their words. This month is their month too, because we're expecting the praise Sunday. Hallelujah. Receive the new fire. God bless you.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I'm sure there's a living house, there's a living soul in the house this morning. Give the Lord a big hallelujah. It's a new beginning. Reaffirm that to yourself that it's a new beginning. It's a new beginning, and God is starting with us afresh. God is here today to start with you afresh. God is ready. Now, are you ready to start with you afresh? You have to be ready to start with you afresh. And I pray the Lord will bless us as we listen to the song in the name of Jesus. Thank you.
tomorrow.
You're faithful and just. In you I put my trust, mighty God, everlasting Father.
Let there be a performance
deliverance of every of your promised words. In Jesus. Mighty name, I pray. Lord, will not do injustice to your word. Father, I pray and I ask, O God, that you help me to declare your total counsel. I will not embellish your word. I will not exaggerate. I will speak only that which you place in my mouth to speak. And you will confirm your word in the heart of your people. In Jesus. Mighty name, we pray.
Amen.
In Jesus' name, Jabez, get up. Good morning, Joe. Praise the Lord. I have a very simple assignment this morning, and that is to. And this is just to give you the. Is it? I think it's my voice, but this microphone is not sounding sharp. It's just to, you know, speak to you guys and to, like, should I use the word, reaffirm what God has said, which coincidentally actually said at the beginning of last month. If you remember last month, the very first Sunday, I spoke about God speaking through me, spoke about, behold, I make all things new. That was the title of last month, the first Sunday. Behold, I make all things new. And Isaiah chapter 42, verse 9, that was where I've been quoted. Revelation 21, verse 5. But I'm just looking at my note here. Revelation chapter 21, verse 5. Isaiah chapter 42, verse 9. Exodus 9, 5 and 6. These were the texts that we read for that message. So this month, when the Lord said to our Father in the Lord that this month is the month of new beginnings, it's like a continuation of what he said he would do for us in Q2, in H2, in second half of the year. Remember, we were talking about that, see, forget about H1, forget about what had happened in the first half of the year, but focus on what God will do in the second half. And that message, if you still remember, we emphasize the fact that in the second half of the year, God will do beyond what he has done in the first half. Whether the first half was pleasant to you or not, whether if I, even if it was pleasant, he will do much more than that. Praise the Lord. And so this month is a continuation of what God said he will do by saying to our Father the Lord, that is a month of new beginnings. Eight is a figure of new beginnings. We're going to have a very short message, because the message is both in the word and in the song. And during the early morning settlement prayer, Minister Bayo took a song, and I looked at my wife because she looked at me as well. That song is the song we're going to take today, because it's the song for the moment, and it's actually the title of my message. He will do it again. Hello.
Amen.
He will do it again. So I want to speak to somebody, one person or two people or three people, online, off, on site, online, that God says he will do it again.
Amen.
The figure 8 symbolizes new beginnings. It's a new, it's a fresh start, a fresh chapter. It's something new, something like a second chance, giving it a second shot, giving it a second attempt. The figure 8 symbolizes a new beginning. So in this season, God is saying to somebody that is creating new sets of opportunities for you to begin again.
Amen.
So perhaps the first 7 months didn't look as pleasant. Perhaps the first 7 months you tried a lot of stuff, you didn't make it. Perhaps the first 7 months was full of ups and downs or disappointments, or you did your best, but it didn't really work out. The 8th month is the month of a second chance to go for it again. Did you apply for that job and you're turned down? It's opportunity to work. Go for it again. Did you try to get a contract and it didn't work out? It's opportunity for you to work. Go for it again. It's a new beginning. So figure 8 represents a new beginning. So this month, God is saying to you that get up and take another shot at that goal or that objective. God is saying that this month, he will do it again. Now, and I began to look at what it means that when he says he will do it. If he said he will do it and he stopped, that would have been a different matter. It says he will do it again, which presupposes that there was a doing in the past. Hello? It says he will do it again, means that there must have been a doing in the past. So this message may not be for everybody. If you have not, if you don't know what I mean, this message particularly is for somebody who has encountered and experienced something in the past, and that thing has dried up, or that thing has fizzled off. I'm feeling uncomfortable with this jacket. It's been a long time I bought a jacket.
It's okay to you. It's okay to you.
Hello, are you still here? Are you still here? Don't be distracted. Are you still here?
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Hi.
God is saying that perhaps you have encountered joy in the past and that joy seemed to have dried off. Perhaps you have encountered pleasantness and that pleasantness seems to have dried off. Perhaps something good had happened to you in the past and it seemed to be lost in the past and it's no longer happening now. May I give you this word from the Lord that he said he will bring it to pass again.
Amen.
So have you witnessed success in the past and it looks as if those successes you witnessed is gone and forgotten? God is saying that I'm bringing again the recurring of success your way.
Amen.
Have you enjoyed prosperity in the past and it looks as if it is gone, and it looks as if, in fact, if you look back and you wonder that, wow, I used to spend dollars. I used to spend, you know, I'm sure some of you must have seen that that stuff that is going around. There's somebody's passport page that was stamped. You know, in 1980, $1,000 was 542 naira, 548 naira or something. How many of you have seen that stuff? Okay, I'll share it with you so I don't see it, but this pastor is from his store. In 1980, you know, if you apply for PTA, if you go to the bank, you apply for PTA, they will stamp your passport for how much you bought, an equivalent. 1,000 naira was 548 naira, not 548,000. 548, meaning that the naira was stronger than the dollar.
Yes.
1980. Somebody applied for $1,000. And he got he paid 548 naira to get $1,000. $1,000 now is 530,000. So Nigeria itself needs a mistake of God. And God will do it again. Yeah. Can I prophesy to Nigeria? The Lord will be the game for Nigeria.
Amen. Yeah.
Yesterday, you know, we normally buy bread from the children's church, we buy butter post. When I started buying butter post, it was 300 naira. So I got to the shop yesterday. I gave the girl 1,000 naira to buy two. She said, okay, 200 naira. I said, are you okay? She said, it's now 600 naira. So over time, butter post had doubled the price. I told my wife, I said, this butter post business, we need to reconsider. Why is it so good? So Nigeria too, it seems as if things seem to have gone out of hand. But we prophesied that God will do it again in this land.
So,
you might have troubled. But I've been traveling. Even as I'm talking to myself. When I used to work in my former organization, I fly business class. We'll be the last. Everybody will have entered. You now call us. It's time for the business and first class. We just walk in, we'll go in, the plane will start. When we get to intro, chauffeur driven vehicle will come and carry us. British Airways, chauffeur driven. Anywhere you're going in the UK, chauffeur driven. I remember the last time I flew business class. God will do it.
Amen.
So you must have experienced or enjoyed prosperity in the past, and it seems as if it's in the past. May I prophesy to you? He said that it will bring prosperity your way again in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Have you climbed up to the zenith of your career or your business, and it looks as if you are stuck or you have even crashed? God is saying, I'm about to launch you again.
Amen.
Amen.
Have you enjoyed good health in the past? But now, you are feeling frail, you are feeling fainting, and you are up today, down tomorrow, up today, and your health is seemingly failing you. God is saying to you, I will restore health unto you again in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Have you enjoyed the good things of life? That some people, once a month, they go and eat out. go to the restaurant, they go to, you know, just have fun and stuff like that. But the economy has battered everybody that they don't even know. They when they are passing that place, just close their eyes, they don't look at that restaurant again. But I used to go to this restaurant, eh? May I say to such people, God is saying that what? He will do it again.
Amen.
When we're younger, we used to look forward to Christmas period. By October, you know, we'll be looking at our parents. Me, I'll be looking at their, you know, because daddy will give mommy money to them. They used to give them in mobile, they used to give them a coupon. That coupon is like a cash, like a gift voucher. You go to Leventis or UTC, or what's the third one? Leventis, UTC, Kingsway. Go to any of those places, you will carry the trolley. A gift voucher of 100 naira, you will feel trolley tired. So I used to watch when this man will come back home and give that voucher to Momsi. So that Momsi, when are we going to UTC or Kingsway or Leventis? Gradually, you know, gift voucher stop coming. Then by November, you start to wait for the day your mom will say, okay, well, take that Jalasolo Tilo. Because once you say Jalasolo Tilo, you know that take up will measure you against what? Christmas dress. But today, that doesn't seem to be happening. Today, in fact, there's no Leventis, there's no Kingsway, there's no UTC. But I mean, Spa has come, Job Letter has come, right? Those ones are here now. May I prophesy to you, those of us who have enjoyed that, you'll be able to do that for your children.
Yeah.
So I will enjoy the goodness of life, and it seems as if it is gone. You just say, oh boy, look at the one where you wear. Thank God, that's why I told the tailor to make sure he sew you one size bigger, so that as you grow into it. That's why when your shoe size 14, but I bought 16 for you, so that you go into it. And then you have, you know, boys, your siblings, boys, the one where Brother Emeka wears, you pass it down to. Oh, there's nothing bad about those things, because those are days of little humble beginnings. But may I prophesy to you truly that the Lord again will bring the good times away in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
Are you falling from a place of honor where they used to hold you in honor and in high esteem? When you step into that place, they respect what you say, they look up to you. They accord you respect. It's just like, again, using the example of traveling. If you carry a frequent flyers card, when you go, all of us will stay at the open place. You go to a lounge, you have a lounge in there because you're a frequent flyer. You carry a gold card.
Mm.
I remember one of my friends carries Lufthansa gold card. You first of all, you are not on the regular queue. You are not, you are treated like a king. First time I went into PA, first class lounge in Heathrow. If you are greedy, you will chop tire. Because, fortunately, my flight was for a short period, so my layover was not long. But the people who had layover for 6 hours, 8 hours, you eat, you forget your flight. And they had places, they had isolated cubicles you could sleep. They had, it's good to have money.
Yes.
May the Lord restore the good times back to
us.
So when you have been held in honor, and then you step in there, because the things that they used to look at you, that made, they used to place in honor, maybe money, maybe position, maybe connection, maybe all of those things, maybe your swag, those things are no longer there. They just look at you, you go, you know, and then they just commonize you. Every eye that has commonized you, may the Lord cause those eyes again to honor you.
Yeah.
So says, I will do it again. God is restoring your honor, is bringing back your glory, your placement, and your voice. Yes, your voice will be heard again.
Amen.
Your voice will command the same authority you used to command again.
Amen.
God is saying that he wants to fulfill in your life 1 Samuel chapter 2 and verse 8. What does 1 Samuel chapter 2 and verse 8 say? What does it say? 1 Samuel chapter 2 and verse 8. Are you there? God is saying that I will raise up the poor. I will raise up the poor out of the dust, and I will lift up the beggar from the dunghill. This poor and this beggar, I will set them among the princes to make them to inherit the throne of glory. For the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and he has set the word upon them. Are you presently being looked at like a beggar? Are you presently being looked like as a poor person? God is saying that I want to do a new thing in you, begin a new beginning, such that I will bring you out of the dust, out of the dunghill, and I will place you among the princes to give you an inheritance in the throne of his glory. May I prophesy to you that an orchestration of divine mercy, you will be raised out of the dust of poverty in the name of Jesus. But an orchestration of divine mercy, you'll be raised out of poverty in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
May I repeat this? By an orchestration of divine mercy, you'll be raised out of poverty in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
You'll be raised out of failure.
Amen.
You'll be raised out of lack.
Amen.
You'll be raised out of penury.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
By God's mighty outstretched arms, you'll be lifted from the dunghill of failure, from the dunghill of shame, from the dunghill of reproach, and from the dunghill of ridicule. And by the operation of the heavenly favor, you will take your place among the princes.
Amen.
And by divine announcement, you will inherit the throne of glory.
Amen.
And spectacle.
Amen.
So, let's listen to the warnings of that song. Uncle Bimbo, are you ready for me? I want that song to minister to you, and then I'll continue my message. But I just want you to listen. God says that he will do it again. Let faith arise in you as this song ministers to you.
Somehow walk up to forgotten you.
He says you may feel down and feel like God has somehow forgotten you. Is that your present situation? Do you actually think that God has forgotten you in the state where you are? Are you thinking that God, I have prayed, I have fasted, I have done everything, I have given offering, I have given tithe, I have rode on the floor, I have gone on the marathon fast, I have gone to the mountain, I have done everything, and you actually think he has forgotten you? That you are faced with circumstances that you can't get through. But right now it seems that there is no way out and you are only going to go under. But God has proven time and time again that he will take care of you. So may I say that he will do again for you in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
If only you take a look at where you are now, compared to where you are. I used to tell somebody, one of my sons that is battling cancer, I said, listen to me. So many people who have cancer like you have died. But you have not died. Why have you not died? The only reason why you have not died is that God does not want you to die. So that is a proof that God will heal you completely. Because if you were going to die, you would have died. But because you did not die, the man was bedridden for 6 months. Hello? Bedridden, 6 months. He had bed sores. In fact, his father at some point thought he was gone. 6 months bedridden, he could not move. God. Today he's up and he's moving, even though it's not fully up, but he's moving now. I spoke with him on Friday. Let's listen to me. God is not forgotten about you just yet. He will do it again for you.
Yeah.
You may not know how, you may not know when, but he will do it again.
Amen.
God will show up for you.
Amen.
That help will come.
Amen.
Don't give up on God just yet. That help will come.
Amen.
That breakthrough will come.
Amen.
That miracle will come.
Amen.
That baby will come.
Amen.
That job will come.
Amen.
That promotion will come.
Amen.
That business will come.
Amen.
In the name of the ambition will come.
Amen.
The victory will come. The Lord will lift your head up on high. In the name of Jesus. For joy comes in morning. Joy comes in the morning. He will do it again. Have you enjoyed money? Money has been in your hand in the past. The Lord will bring money again to you. Your hand will hold money, correct money, true money. Correct money. When I mean money, correct money. You will count money. In the name of Jesus. Have this been scarce in your life, in your family? You last time you check your pantry, you said, madam, please, I want to eat rice and turkey. Say, rice, come, turkey in. The last time we saw rice in this house was like a month ago. I said, what has happened here? May I prophesy to you, the bags of rice will come back to your pantry again. The bags of rice will come back to your pantry again. The chicken you used to eat, you eat again. How the Lord will do it, I don't know. He said, that's why he says, take a look at where you are now and where you have been. The same God who has done the turnaround, he will bring the turnaround for you in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
I remember when I first joined my former organization, because of, you know, I would calculate to the last kobo money for snacks in the morning and lunch. Calculate to, if I just meet somebody, maybe I went to a restaurant and I jump a friend or a colleague. That means that if I pay for that guy, I don't go talk to the second one. So that was how much I was calculating it. I was looking in the bank, that was how much I was calculating it. One day, some years after, I took account of how much I spent, you know, like out of pocket. It was more than the salary I was earning at that time. Now, so God had brought about change of levels. May I prophesy to you, there will be a change of level.
Yeah.
May I prophesy to you, change of levels in the name of Jesus. Somebody is here and you are saying that, God, I've had it before. You are saying that I've had it before. And it looks as if this message is only come to excite, but it has not manifested. I see not my sign. If only you believe the word of the Lord and the word in the mouth of his prophet. Truly, truly, there will be change of levels for you.
Yes,
there will be change of levels for you.
Amen.
Listen to me. You know, I told us, I said, look at, I'll put it on the workers' platform when I have that sermon, so you know that this man. When Naira was stronger than the dollar, some people still did not travel. Now that Naira is, $1 is 530 Naira. That is when some people are traveling. When the Naira to the pound was 1-1, some people could not afford it. I don't even know what pounds is doing now. Maybe it'll be doing 600 or something, going to 700. Now that pounds is 700, that is when some people actually school in the UK. Oh, I thought somebody would say amen to that. Oh, your faith level is not yet arisen. May I say to you, by the word of the Lord, as you are not of this world, the economy of this world, though it may be pinching you, but may I say to you, if you keep your focus away from the economy of this world and keep your focus on the economy of God and say that you are from heaven, you are from above, therefore you are above all, because your economy is not the economy of this world, for my God shall supply. It is not Babuari that is supplying. It is not the civil that is supplying. It is not your employer that is supplying. It is not your friend that are supplying. He says, but my God shall supply my need. So keep your eyes on God. Keep your focus on God. Don't look at the economy of, if you look at the economy of Nigeria, your faith level will be down. But you say, I lift up my eyes to the hills. From whence cometh my help? My help cometh from where? I changed the naira to the Canadian dollar at 290. Early this year, it had jumped to 390. For changing 5,000 Canadian dollars, I lost 500,000. Or, don't let me say I lost, but it had depreciated or deteriorated by 500,000. Do the math. 290 to 390 is a 100 naira difference. 100 times 5,000. Cost of that difference. But are those guys still there? They are still there. Am I still going to pay their school fees? I'll still pay their school fees. How? How to make us do more? As I said, so let your eyes be on the Lord. Keep your focus on Him. How He will make it happen, you'll have to make it happen. Anyhow, He's going to do it, we'll make sure to do it. Because of time, let's move a bit faster. So, listen to me. God has always been in the business of doing it again and restoring to make a way out of the wilderness and out of the storms of life for you. let's look at a case study. There are two case studies here, but the way I'm looking at it, I'm not sure we'll have time for two case studies. So I have the case study of Job, I have the case study of Naomi. But I find the case study of Naomi very interesting. So let's look at the case study of Naomi. So go to Ruth. I found that quite interesting. So go to Ruth. Ruth. If you are familiar with the story, you know some of the points here. So, Ruth chapter 1. Verse 2. And, okay, so verse 1. Ruth 1. Now, it came to pass in the days when the judges ruled that there was a famine in the land, and a certain man of Bethlehem, Judah, went to sojourn in the country of Moab. He and his wife and his two sons. And the name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife, Naomi, and the name of his two sons, Mahlon and Chilion, Ephrathites of Bethlehem, Judah. And they came into the country of Moab and continued there. So this is the opening chapter for this lady called Naomi. This lady called Naomi had a husband. Hello? How many people pray to have husbands? You have not married and you want to have husband. Raise up your hand. You don't want to have husband? Okay. Did I say now? I said, who is not married that wants to have husband? Did I say now? This is how people fail exam. We are inside a prophetic church. If you are not married and you want to have husband, ultimately, raise up your hand. Let me see your hand. So it's a good thing to have husband. I didn't say now. You go to school, you're an apocalypse. Now, so she has husband, which is the desire of most ladies, right? Not only did she have husband, she gave back to children. With due respect, please, permit me to say this. Not just children, boys. You know, in African context, we like men, we like boys. I don't know what is wrong with our mentality. Why we think men are better at this thing. So she had a husband and she had two sons. Now, these two sons now went out on to the soldier, went to go and marry two beautiful ladies. So Naomi, in all intents and purposes, was a what? A fulfilled woman. She had a husband, she had two sons, and she had daughters-in-law. And they were doing okay in a strange land. So they were prosperous in a strange land. Are you still with me? Because you guys are looking at me funny.
Yes, sir.
So this is the story of Naomi. This is how the chapter of Naomi began. Hello? This is how the chapter of Naomi began. So Naomi, husband, sons, daughters-in-law, everything was going very well for Naomi. Verse 3. Suddenly, there was a turn of events. Suddenly, like we have been saying, and we are going to prophesy again, and Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left with her two sons. Verse 5. And Mahlon and Chilion died also, both of them. And the woman was left over two sons and her husband. How does a woman go from being a wife, having a husband, a mother with two sons, go within a space of two verses, lose husband, lose sons? Let me read some of the things I wrote here. Naomi started out as a proud wife and mother of two promising sons, who also had two beautiful wives. She could be regarded as a lucky, favored, or a blessed woman. In fact, she probably was envious. I mean, she was envied by a lot of people because it would have been, I wish I'm in this man's shoe. Husband, sons, and daughters-in-law. Now, grandchildren, then they wait for. So, Naomi was envied. Then disaster struck. And Naomi lost her husband and her two sons in rapid succession. It will appear that the world of Naomi collapsed on her. And she dropped the appellation. Even if you lose one son, another one should be there. But you now lose husband and lose your two sons in rapid succession. So the world of Naomi collapsed on her. And Naomi all of a sudden saw herself fall from grace to crash. Naomi saw herself now like open, naked, and exposed. And all of a sudden, Naomi, who could wear and go to Paris with her husband, would not have to wear sad clothes. Naomi, who could say, Mahlon, am I riding in your car? Or the other one, am I riding in your car? All of a sudden now, no car to ride in. It looks as if that Naomi was now in a state of helplessness. In fact, Because of that, Naomi had to return from Moab back to Bethlehem. She returned empty. She returned dry. She returned naked. She returned shamefully. How do I know that? Look at Ruth chapter 1 and verse 20. Naomi returned back to Bethlehem, naked, bare, empty, and shallow. Ruth 1:20. And she said unto them, call me not Naomi, call me Mara, for the Almighty had dealt very bitterly with me. Now, don't call me Naomi, call me Mara. That is, I'm bitter. I don't have anything to offer. I went out full, and the Lord had brought me home again empty. I don't know who is in that position and who is in that state, and feel that I used to, you know, I was into a message of that he said, when you use the word I used to, that means that it is no longer in the current, it's no longer happening in the present. I used to drive a G-Wagon. I used to. So it's still the past. So Naomi says that I'm no longer Naomi, I'm now what? However, the story of Naomi did not end in that state or in that status. The story of Naomi, because it is the God who does it again, is the God of a second chance, is the God of new beginnings, is the God of a second and a third and a fourth chance, is the God that always remembers. It didn't end in that state of Mara. Naomi's state or story ended pleasantly. John 2 chapter 4 of Ruth. Luke chapter 4, verse 14 and 15. Luke chapter 4, verse 14 and 15. And the women said unto Naomi, blessed be the Lord. This same woman who probably would have given to her, say, came. And the women said unto Naomi, blessed be the Lord, which hath not left thee this day without a king's man, that his name may be famous in Israel. And it shall be unto thee a restorer of thy life. So the path of Obed was a restorer of Naomi's life, of everything that Naomi had ever lost. The inheritance, the heritage, the lineage, everything came back. And a nourisher of thy old age, for thy daughter-in-law, which loveth thee, which is better to thee than seven sons. So Naomi, if you had seven sons, it could not compare to Ruth. So they were saying to Naomi that we see that your latter end is better. Because guess what? If you had seven sons and they were just one, they would not have been able to compare to Ruth. This your daughter-in-law, which is better to thee than seven sons, had born this young man. And Naomi took the child and laid it in her bosom and became a nurse. Now, listen to this. You are all familiar with the story. Naomi, by virtue of the lineage, became the great-grandmother of David. David the king. So the story of David, King David, is not complete without the mention of Naomi. So it's possible that Elimelech and his two sons may not have had this same lineage that God, through, because he's the God of restoration, he's the God of a second chance, said that I will not just restore this lady, I will put her in inheritance, put her in the heritage, put her in the lineage where ultimately Jesus Christ will come from. The latter end of Naomi. So Naomi, okay, let's go into the lessons learned. But let me go ahead of myself before I break down the lessons. Now, why did Elimelech leave Bethlehem? Because of famine. But there was a man who remained even when there was famine. The name of that man is called Boaz. That guy was spectacularly rich. So, all of a sudden, because of divine orchestration, Naomi became the mother-in-law to Boaz. Because Ruth married Boaz. So, by virtue of everything that Ruth was to Naomi, anything that Naomi wanted, because Ruth now had not become Mrs. Boaz, Naomi had full access to the world of Boaz. So now we stop living in thatch houses, stop living in any kind of house. Now we move into the mansion, one of the mansions of Mr. Buaz. The latter end of Naomi was obviously better than the beginning. That is why we know that the God of resurrection, the God of He will do it again, will do it again for you.
Amen.
So the first lesson we learn is that God never left Naomi desolate or comfortless. Ruth remained with her through thick and thin. So, lesson for you, my brother, my sister, irrespective of what you may be going through right now, God will never leave you comfortless. God will never leave you alone. Because even when, is it Oprah? What's the second the woman's name?
Oprah.
She left. Ruth said, look at Ruth chapter 1 and verse 16. And Ruth said, entreat me not to leave thee or to return from following thee. For whither thou wast, I will go. And whither thou lodgest, I will lodge. Thy people shall be my people, and thy God my God. Where thou didst lie down, and there I will be buried. And the Lord do so more for me, if aught but death part thee and me. So, whatever you are going through, now we might have thought that everything, as everyone has decided me, everything is turned upside down. Everything, in fact, she said her name is Mara, right? But she forgot that there was somebody that remained with her. So, in your situation, there is the Holy Ghost that stays with you, because He's the comforter, He's your confidant, He's your strength, He's your guide, He's your guard, He's the one who remains always with you. John chapter 14 and verse 16. Jesus says that I will not leave you comforted. I will send the comforter unto you. So, brethren, whatever you are going through, whatever you're having to deal with, I will pray the Father, and He shall give you another comforter that He may abide with you for a few moments. Forever. So, note this. This is the lesson we learned from the story of Naomi. That even that the state you are in right now, that looks as if it's impalpable, that looks as if it's whatever, the Holy Spirit is with you. Even in your darkest hours. So, even when you pass through the waters, through the fire, He says that He will be with you, He will not leave you nor forsake you. Isaiah chapter 43 and verse 2. So, in your darkest hours, in your trying moments, in your period of cry, in your period of pain, in your period of disappointment, in the period when they malign you, in the period when you do not have to eat, in the period when you are sick in your body and it looks as if there's no healing coming to you, at that moment, notice, God has not forgotten you. When thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee, and through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. When thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burnt, neither shall the flame kindle upon thee. So, when you are going through this, remember, you are not alone. It may look as if you are alone, but remember, you are not alone. Even in your low estate and seemingly helpless and hapless condition, God's kindness still reaches out and will still always reach out to you. Look at Ruth. Go back to Ruth. There's something I saw in Ruth chapter 2 and verse 20. Ruth chapter 2 and verse 20. And Naomi said unto her daughter-in-law, blessed be he of the Lord, who hath not left of his kin, who hath not left of his kindness to the living and to the dead. And Naomi said unto her, the man is near of kin, kin unto us, one of the next kinsmen. He says, blessed be the Lord, who hath not left of his word, his kindness to the living and to the dead. God hath not left of his kindness. It may look as if God is not there, but know this. I'm giving you this assurance that God has not left off His kindness. Now, take a cue from Ruth. Even in Ruth, we learn a lesson in patience and steadfastness. For Ruth, she could have said, this superhead did too much. Don't be me kill my father-in-law. Maybe me kill my husband. If you like say the thing where they stop, say this woman be witch, it may be true. And she could easily have turned back. She could easily have done what? Turned back. Because she started out enjoyment. Now surprise come. But she stayed impatient. She stayed patiently and steadfastly. She could have forsaken Naomi. Or even when she came back with Naomi to Bethlehem, she could have followed other promising men. In these days, they call them, is it sugar? They don't call it sugar daddy, but they say sugar tea or something like that. Something I've seen on Facebook, they say it's not sugar daddy again. What is it now?
Zaggy.
Zaggy, eh? So she could have followed Zaggy.
Zaggy.
Oh, Zaggy, I'm sorry. She could have followed Zaggy, right? But she chose the path of honor and consistency. Look at the testimony that was said of her. Ruth 3:10. Boaz said, "Blessed be thou of the Lord, my daughter, for thou hast shown more kindness in the latter end than at the beginning, insomuch as thou followest not young men, whether they are poor or rich." You have not chased young men. You have not defied yourself. You have not lowered your standard even to make ends meet. So, brethren, even when you are going through, do not understand that, because there's going to be light just at the bend of the corner. Ruth could have easily compromised. Ruth could have easily said, before uncle come and give me this straight line, let me get a positive town. But she stood and stayed steadfast and held on to her profession, more importantly, to the confession of who she was. And her patience and her steadfastness paid off. Because of her consistency and steadfastness, particularly her commitment to her mother-in-law, she became the first lady of the Boaz dynasty. Because of time, we didn't read the whole chapter. She entered into the farm of Boaz as a by-reaper, not the reaper. So the reapers would have gone ahead. She would go behind, picking what the reapers left, the crumbs. That's how she entered the farmland of Boaz. So she was a by-reaper. So when the reapers have gone, they've taken the good ones. Let me, you see a corn that is withering away. Just drop down that this withering, I don't want it. So that is the one that Ruth would pick. So she was living from hand to mouth. She was picking the crumbs in that farmland. But because of her stay, her consistency, and because she remained steadfast on God, she became the first lady of the Boaz dynasty. Guess what? She became the co-owner of that plantation, the co-owner of that estate, the co-owner of the entire world of Boaz. So she could call those people that are going, that used to be ahead of her, "Hey, my guy, you are not able to say very well. Go back. That is what happens when you stay and stay true to God. When you don't cut corners, when you don't bow, when you don't, you know, do corner, when you wait on God and you say, "God, I'm waiting on thee. Show up for me." When God shows up, he shows up big time. Who would anybody have thought that Ruth, a stranger? How come Boaz did not find any other Jewish girl to marry? But this lady, Boaz himself used his mouth to confess. He said that, "And blessed be thou of the Lord, my daughter, for thou hast shown more kindness in the latter end than at the beginning." Because she didn't follow, you know, cheap men. So she became the first lady of the Boaz dynasty. She became the co-owner of the vast estate. Added to that, she became the forebear of the king of the king David. Because she gave back to Obed gave back to Jesse gave back to King David. So anywhere where you read the lineage of David, and by extension the lineage of Jesus, the name Ruth would always come. She became celebrated, and she was held in honor and in high esteem. Her days of waiting, suffering, and pain were gone. God turned her mourning into dancing again. As I end my sermon, Uncle People, let's have on Kenoli. God turned her mourning into dancing again, and this shall be your testimony.
Yeah.
I say to you, this shall be your testimony.
Yeah.
Every day of cry, of mourning, every day of sorrow and sadness, every day of darkness is gone, and God turns it positively for your joy in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
In the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
Get ready. Yeah. Because he's going to do a new thing. He says, "I will do a new thing to spring forth." He's turned your mourning to dancing.
My sorrow, I can't say silent. I won't. Thank you.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Can we package our offering? Let's pray. Thanking God, first of all, for the one that has located us today. Thanking God for new beginnings in our lives. Thanking God for that which God will do. What eye has not seen, what ear has not heard, what God will do concerning us. The restoration that is coming our way. The double portion, I'll call it, that is coming our way. And with that, the heart of thanksgiving, we bring forth our offering, because we know we cannot come into His presence empty-handed. We thank you, Lord, for the seeds in our hands. We thank you, Lord, because out of the abundance you have blessed us, we have brought this token. Lord, we ask that you accept us and you accept the seeds in our hands in the name of Jesus. As we sow this seed, just like the principle of sowing and harvest cannot seed, even as we sow our seeds today, we use it to procure our harvest in these new beginnings in the mighty name of Jesus. We use it to procure the impossible. We use it to procure that turnaround in this new month and in this month of new beginnings, even till the end of this year. We procure it, we receive it, we will testify of it in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
We pray, O Lord, for those that have their tithe as well, that are giving their tithe. We pray for the blessing that comes with tithing. Do not elude them in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
In this period that they are giving their tithe, will not be tied for them in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Everywhere and every time they call upon you, Lord, that they need resources, that they need finances, however way, Lord, you supply all needs in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Father, we give you praise, we give you glory, Lord, that we can be partakers of your principles and thereafter the blessings that come with it. Giving you praise, O Lord, in Jesus' mighty name we have prayed.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. All right, let's rise up and celebrate our offering. This month in Jesus' name.
Amen.
All right, immediately after the service, the meeting of the boards and heads and assistants were called, the board meeting. We didn't have a meeting last month, so we're having a meeting this Sunday. Oh, I just got an announcement here that the men are to wait behind. So I'm going to give the men 5 minutes, because here it's written that you want to meet for 5 minutes. So give the men 5 minutes. And immediately they meet. The boa, ideally the boa should take, should come first. But we give them 5 minutes to meet, and then afterwards the boa meeting will take place. So please, let's all be here. Our midweek service will continue. So you can please join us online on Facebook and on Instagram. The midweek service will hold on Wednesday. We hold it every Wednesday, called Equipping the Saints. The time is 6 p.m. Please log in what are all those things you say? IGN, Facebooking, Apple question.
Follow.
Follow. Like. Follow. Like. Share. Follow
us.
Share everything. God bless you as you do that in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Next week, Sunday, the Ladies for God, we'll be having our meeting as well. So please, ladies in the house, like us to get prepared. We didn't have a meeting. Last month was our convention. So we are meeting this month for a special place. Because our usual venue is the Children's Church, and the time is after service. We'll be here after service. In this month of August, again, the last Sunday of the month, we're going to be having a special program packaged. It's our Praise Sunday. So it's going to be awesome. It's the last Sunday. Usually our last Sundays are testimonies, praise, Thanksgiving. So combined with praise, it's going to be awesome. We're going to be seeing the newly fired Hallelujah, PWC in action. And then we ourselves will not be left out. It's not only the choir. Will not be left out in praising God and testifying of His goodness. So join us this month for all our programs. And I'm not sure about the fasting and prayer. We should have one for the month, but the senior pastor has not he has not gotten across to us. So if he does, we'll surely let you. Hallelujah.
Amen.
All right, is anyone worshiping with us for the first time? Can we see your hand up? Hallelujah. God bless you.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So today is the first day. Today is the first day of the week, the first day of the month, and the first day of the second month in the second half. And today is the birthday of one and only world famous Mommy Nesh. Can we celebrate the grace of God upon our life? She's opened the month. And so can we stretch out our hands and as we pray for her? I just release blessing into her life and ask that God will bless her and bless her abundantly. God will cause her to experience even greater heights. She can experience heights. She's presently at high levels, but the higher levels that God will take her, even heights we would not have seen, ears would not have heard, it would not have entered into the heart of men. Everything good, everything gracious, everything bountiful, everything nice that God will package for her. Pray that the Lord will visit her and grant her innermost heart desire as a special money package. Lord, whatsoever things she has is asked you that is stuck on her lips to God, Lord, do for her. Lord, establish this for her, O God. Then I come back next year with testimony that I check my list. My prayer list and every prayer there have been answered. Let me be able to come back next day with this testimony that I look and I saw that truly every prayer point that becomes testimony. Sir, pray for her, for her husband, for her children, greater levels, greater lifting, blessings the Lord in all fronts. Pray for her business, that the Lord will cause her business to prosper. She will not be stranded in the journey of life. Pray for the Lord. She will be a favorable magnet. People who do good, genuine, profitable business will come her way, and she will be connected to them. Pray that she will be announced. One of the things that God said to me when I was praying for this morning is that it's a season of announcement. Pray the Lord will truly announce her, and that she will be a force to be reckoned with in every line of business that she goes to. She will not be duped. She will not suffer loss. That anyone with authority will not see her do business with her. Let's pray that she be circumspect. She will be led of God, and then everything about her will prosper. Whatever she lays her hands upon, she will prosper. She will not fall. She will not break down. She will not be sick. She's a virtuous woman. She will feed her own house, her own home. Her husband and her children will call her blessed, and she will continually dwell in prosperity, in safety, and in security. By extension, pray for our husband and pray for our children that everything good that the Lord is doing in their lives, they will continue to enjoy it more and more in the name of Jesus. Giving you praise and glory and honor in Jesus' mighty name we are praying. Father, we thank you for your daughter whose birthday it is today, and anyone else that we may not know whose birthday it is today. We pray that you will bless her. Bless her indeed. Lord, the servant of Abraham said, that the Lord had blessed my master indeed.
Yes.
Lord, I pray that you bless her indeed. Let the blessing be obvious. A blessing that is indeed is a blessing that nobody can guess. Even the most critical person will not be able to guess it. Therefore, Lord, bless her indeed in the name of Jesus. Let her experience and encounter everything good in righteousness do for her. do for her husband, do for her children. In every area, she's trusting you, God, for one lifting or the other, for one door or the other to open. Open up their own accord unto her. Let her enter into sweatless victory. Enter into a season of announcement. Let her business overall prosper. Let people that will deal with her deal genuinely with her. And let her, oh God, enjoy the fruit of her labor. As she is a woman of God, a virtuous woman, she will build her own house of God. She will build her own home of God. It will not be scattered. Lord, we pray for her. Everything that she requires, God, to live a holy and a godly life, to be a blessing to this generation, give unto her, equip her to do so. She will not fall, she will not fail, she will not break down. Lord, the plans of the enemy where she's concerned will not come to pass. You will continually fortify her. Her joy over her husband and her children will be full. Her joy in her ministry will be full. And she will always have testimony. We rejoice with her, and every one of us who rejoices with her. Business will rejoice with her message from her own. We give you back all the praise and glory. In Jesus' mighty name we are praying.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
All right, after we share the grace, a little bird whispered to me that there's a cave to be cut. Now, by the instruction of our Father and the Lord, starting from today, just before we share the grace, we'll take the second stanza of the national anthem. We believe very strongly that God has planned and proposed for this land. There's a message that Pastor Tony Bakari shared. I don't know how many of us have listened to a powerful message, prophetic message. I believe very much in that message. Nigeria will not scatter.
Amen.
Whatever the plans of the enemy are, I say, and I've had Mr. Bayo reiterate it. The reason why we are agitating for self-determination and let's go as a is because there's injustice, there's unfairness, and there's lopsidedness. If there's free transparency, every one of us, we are enjoying the common world. One person is not feeling cheated against the other. Well, this is how much we made, and we share to the common world proportionately. And there's equity and fairness. We are all good, right? So that's it's because we feel that this other part of this our marriage is cheating me. Let me go my own way. But God will yet bring equity, will yet bring, you know, peace in our land in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So, come rise up on our feet. We're going to take the second stanza.
Amen.
Surely, God's goodness and mercy follow us all the days of our lives,
How shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever in Jesus' name? Amen. Psalm 16 and verse 11. For the Lord will show us the path of life, for his presence is fullness of joy, at his right hand shall bless us forevermore. Amen. Shalom. The Lord bless you. Have a great and a glorious week, and a great and glorious month ahead. Shalom.